did not fit in because I wasn't like everybody else in the neighborhood, doing things as a family. Get out of my way. I need a perfect turkey for my family. We need family time. Did you know nothing's more important than family? No, it isn't. I came from one.
Good morning, everyone.
Isn't that a nice guest? He welcomes you before even the host does. I think it's perfect.
Yes, I was worried about them.
Well, I'm worried about them too.
Yeah, because they could be sad.
Are you
Anyone
sad?
Could be sad at any time. That's how the world works.
But we won't be sad in an hour. An hour will be joyously happy and
It'll
inspired
go by like
and
this.
Like, boom. Well, I want to welcome you all to the Banff Center Talk. And I want to let you know that this whole extravaganza is going to be filmed and recorded for Banff Center Live and on the radio. So it'll be commemorated for posterity, which is great because this is like a hometown-ish visit for Bruce, right?
Correct, yes.
Alberta, we own you.
Yes, mostly Calgary and some of Edmonton, but Banff as well.
Excellent, excellent. So I don't know how many of you were in the audience last night for Bruce's show or were able to see it at the High Performance Rodeo in Calgary.
I was in the audience, and that's why the show wasn't very good.
No? Seriously?
Apparently I'm supposed to be on stage, but here I am now on stage, so this is going to be much better.
Absolutely. So I was thinking about like interviewing a comedian and what his friends call a comedic genius. They actually call him that, and not with any kind of bitterness. Did you know that?
Yeah, but they have their fingers crossed behind their back, which is apparently a sign of disrespect.
Okay, all fingers showing, all fingers showing,
Come on,
everyone.
Let's see your hands.
Let's see, everybody, hands up. Okay, we're good, no disrespect. And I was thinking about, like, when you do interview a comedian, like, the point, right, is to make them feel really comfortable.
Right, of course.
And I was thinking about Johnny Carson, because he was, like, the best, they say, at interviewing
right.
comedians. And they said, well, what did Johnny do? And they said, well, Johnny laughed. And I thought,
right.
well, I laughed a lot last night. And I know that all of you laughed a lot, so it's you're comfortable, right? You know that you're among laughers.
Yes, of course, I'm very comfortable.
And people who laugh at you without their fingers crossed.
I love it.
It's excellent. Okay, so I don't know how much you all know about Bruce McCulloch. I think a lot of us think of you as almost family or a friend. There's SNL, obviously. He was a track and field star.
I was a competitive weightlifter when I was 18.
Wow.
What the snatch and the clean and jerk. I did that stuff.
I will not have him demonstrate. The word snatch makes me deeply uncomfortable.
Of course.
Okay.
But I'm illegally allowed to use it in that context. That's why I like to use it in that context.
He's 1.67 meters tall?
Yes.
According to Wikipedia, which I thought was fascinating.
Yeah, I didn't know how they knew.
Because they, and did they measure you for things
like that?
Did they
say I'm shrinking?
That would mean that you were used to be 1.7 centimeters?
Yeah, no, that'd be terrible.
That'd be terrible.
Well, they know what my house is worth and that I'm shrinking. They know too much.
You know what? I actually Google searched you at one point when we were going to work together, and I know what your house is worth.
I know.
Isn't that the wildest thing? There's way too much information.
You sent it
out
to
there.
Me, and it was like, oh, maybe we should sell now.
You are also a musician. You've had two records, Shame Based Man and Drunk Baby Project, and you did Shame Based Man with Bobby Wiseman.
Yes, I did.
Who was the original keyboardist for Blue Rodeo, and is also genuinely a genius.
He is a genius, but I think they kind of got tired of him in the band because he would play all his parts and then just like read a book because it got so easy to him after two times. So yeah, he's actually a genius.
So one of the reasons I bring up Bob is that Bruce has had an entire career of working with people who are equally genius-like.
Yes, of course, and Brian Connelly, who
exactly.
played in the show that some people saw last night, who is the best guitarist I've ever seen in my life.
And was Brian Connelly from Shadowy Men? It's not like Shadowy Men happened and then Bruce met him. You guys were friends from the time you were 13 on.
Oh yeah, no, he was the boss of me, because he was 2 years older than me when I met him, and I did anything he wanted me to do, and he taught me everything about music, rock music, and sort of being cool, but yes, no.
You're very cool. You're totally cool. In fact, I think we all know that you caused cancer.
I did cause cancer. It was a character I did on our film Brain Candy, our one-star disaster, a boy called Cancer Boy, who I thought was a beautiful character because I love the spirit of Cancer Boy and, you know, I think cancer children. And I remember thinking, oh, if a Cancer Boy goes into remission, does he still get to meet Wayne Gretzky? And that was the impetus for that thing. And of course, I did Cancer Boy. And then many years later, Scott Thompson, my troupe mate, got cancer. So when we did some material recently in Toronto with the kids in the hall, we got to rewrite a sketch about how I caused Scott's cancer.
But did you apologize?
Kind of.
Got it.
Well, he's spilt a lot of coffee on me over the years, so I think we're evil.
Even?
Even. I said, I think I'm evil. Therapy topic.
Therapy topic. Okay. So there's also the directing stuff. You're a pretty swell director. So he did Dog Park, Superstar with Molly Shannon, and there's a little Molly Shannon project in the work for you too?
Yes, I'm writing a script for Fox TV that may or may not go, because that's American television.
We're going to get to that, folks, later, but we can all now say that we know somebody who may have a deal with Fox.
Right.
Which is kind of cool. Comeback Season, which I loved, starring Ray Liotta, and shot in Calgary.
Yes, of course.
Yeah.
And Edmonton.
And, oh, I didn't know it was in Edmonton, too.
Yeah, we did some stuff in Edmonton.
Why
as well.
Edmonton? Why did you let them in?
Because it's a beautiful place to look at, but not live. Just kidding.
Okay. And then there was Carpoolers, which was his one season, way ahead of its time series.
Well, thank you.
It was Modern Family before Modern Family.
Thank you so much.
You're very welcome. Yeah, it made me very angry when they got rid of it. It wasn't fair.
And us too.
Yeah.
And then the strike happened. We were doing this was a show I had on ABC. I did 13 episodes, and there was a strike, and I couldn't even talk to anybody. And they were finishing like the last couple episodes, and I remember Jerry O'Connell phoning saying, "I know I'm not supposed to talk to you, but it feels like the state took my papa." I thought that was so cool.
You're Jerry O'Connell's papa.
Yeah, I didn't know. I'm so happy.
Woo. Okay. So you mentioned Wayne Gretzky. So you were born in 1961, as was Wayne Gretzky.
Yes,
and it
I
was
know.
A killer year for people who are famous who were born. So we've got George Clooney, Michael J. Fox, The Karate Kid was born that year, Ricky Gervais.
Oh.
Heather Locklear. Mm-hmm. Did you ever meet Heather Locklear?
No, I didn't. I'd like to.
Yeah.
Is she here in Banff?
We could arrange that next
nice.
Time. Next time, so we'll bring him back to meet Heather Locklear. Amy Sedaris.
Uh-huh.
Henry Rollins. But this is the part. So I found this list of the most famous people born in 1961. You actually came out at number 232, which is killer. Given that, do you know who you're ahead of?
Who?
Barack Obama.
Wow.
You are more famous, according to the internet, than Barack Obama.
Well, I feel I am. Is that weird?
I thought maybe a Republican had created the list.
Yes, I think so.
Anyway, I like that a lot.
Hey, I should have done that joke. That's an excellent joke.
You like that?
Yeah, I did.
Oh, God. Okay, now it's all about you. So what did it take for you to get into that pantheon? Like, because you're a guy, like, we all know you. Like, we all grew up like you. So how did you get there?
Get to be famous?
Jerry O'Connell's daddy.
Well, I'm not famous. I'm just this little famous. Some people know me, most people don't. Because I worked really hard. And once you go on TV, then everything changes. People see your face, and they think they know you, especially because I'm not playing like an aristocratic weirdo. You know, I'm playing kind of me in the Kids in the Hall stuff, and things that I do are written from my own life. So when people see me, they kind of think they know me. And I play Bruce, and I am Bruce. So, you know, yeah.
There was a Kids in the Hall sketch that I found, and it was about, you know, how to break into show business, how to, you know, get a career. And you basically said, let liquor be the wind with the wind
beneath your wings. Yeah, I said, move to the biggest city you can find and get a TV show. That was my advice to young artists.
So,
because I always hate when people say follow your dreams, because I actually do believe in people following their dreams, but it can set people on a path which is like, okay, I have the same dream as everybody else. Your dream doesn't have to be on American Idol and win American Idol. So I think the follow your dream thing was just starting at that time, and I was sort of, in my mind, rebelling against that notion.
Got it. And one of your other things, and it was in your show last night, Young Drunk Punk, about the idea that you're an outsider.
Without question.
And that no one understands you.
Well, it's two things. I thought I was an outsider as a young man trying to form what my personality was, figuring out where I fit in the world. And then, of course, as I found people like Brian Connelly and eventually the Kids in the Hall, and more importantly, the people in the audience who connected with the Kids in the Hall work, I realized that there were a lot of outsiders. And I was part of a big, wonderful community of people who thought the world was effed up. And we all agree on that, and we're all together in that.
It's just so funny for me in that your humor is so specific, right? Your references are so specific, and they feel really authentic, and they really resonate with me. And I'm a freak. I am not a mainstream person, and yet your humor has become somewhat mainstream. Do you feel like things are changing, though, that the 2.5 men syndrome is going to take over, and there won't be room for these little absurdist, wonderful jewels?
Well, no. I think weird things are in better shape than ever. When you think of David Sedaris or something, he'll do a show and 2,000 people will come hear him read. You know, people are, I think, really thirsty for that kind of thing. You know, there's a different problem, which is from the top, which it's hard for people like me to get TV shows, to get films made, because you need millions of dollars. And so I think from the top, it's always a problem. But from the bottom, it never is, because you can communicate with as many people as you can find. And to me, I honestly don't care if there's 100 people to see my show or 300 people to see my show. I'd rather have a full theater, but I don't care how many people, you know, or how many people watch Carpoolers. If 5 million people had watched it, I'd still be on the air, but only 4 million people watched it. And I don't care about that. I just want to communicate with the people I can find, and that can be a problem when it's a business.
Absolutely. But you're good at the business. You wouldn't be, you know, where you are right now if you weren't good at the business. And I think for a lot of us, we don't, it's like we have an idea, but we don't know how to sell it. So can you talk a little bit, can you walk us through a pitch? What's it like when you go into the pitch?
Well, I have actually sold several pilots to ABC, NBC, Fox, HBO, all the networks, and two to some of them. What you do is you get an idea, and you start thinking about it. You talk to your writing assistant. You start writing up things, and then you have a character that's going to be like this, and this is what it's about. So you develop a pitch as you walk around like a crazy man in your small office, and your children, you know, are hearing you mutter to yourself. And you finally have the pitch ready. You go and pitch it to your producing partners. That I have a couple of great producing partners in America, and then you get a time. And then you go to NBC. Should we go to NBC first, or should we go to Fox first? No, I think this is more an NBC show. So let's go to CBS first, because, you know, they're going to want it. And then you can tell NBC where you really want to be, where it's going to be. And then you go in, and there's always like 7 people. 2 or 3 of them never speak. They may shake your hand, and they say, can we get you anything? And I always say, yeah, I'm just a lobster. And that joke always works, and then I say, and then they laugh, and then I sometimes, if I'm feeling good, go, can I get a lobster? Like, I really want a lobster. Like, it's going to become a problem. And then they might laugh, and we'll see. So we talk a little bit, and then my manager, who has other shows, will talk a little bit, and then we sit down, and they go, so? And then I'll go, okay, here's what I'm thinking about. And then I talk about the show, why I thought of it, what I did, and then I become Willie Loman for a little while. I take out my samples, and I make it sound like I haven't memorized kind of what I'm doing. I change little details, like when I do a show. And then at the end, they ask a couple questions, and they go, great, so fantastic to have you in here. And sometimes they go, well, we want to do it. We want to buy it. And you go, well, that would be great. And then you leave. And you go, they bought it. And then you go, do we want to be here? Do we want to be at CBS? You go, yeah, they just bought it. And then sometimes they go, well, think about it. And you go, oh, you're not going to buy it? And then you leave. And sometimes then you get into your car, and they'll get a call right away from your agent, who they phoned, within 3 minutes. And they go, it's not really for them. And sometimes they go, we need the weekend. And you either sell it or don't sell it.
But selling it isn't getting it made.
Oh, no, Lord. Selling it means that they are going to commit to a fee to write it. And so a lot of show business, especially large television, is, you know, I make my living sort of on failure, in a sense. They buy, you know, Fox now, where I have a script right now, they probably bought 50 or 45 scripts, and they'll make maybe 8 pilots, and then they'll do maybe 2 shows. So the numbers are gruesome. So you kind of make your living like it's not going to happen. Oh, it looks good. Oh, that one didn't go either. So that's the curse of the industry, of that part of the industry I'm in.
How do you manage that? Is it by doing shows like Young Drunk Punk where you can control it and you can stage it and it's all about?
Oh yeah, no, I think
a yes is a yes.
I got really sick of doing that or even writing a film, you know, for a studio that never gets made and probably people don't actually ever get together and read it, and it's like you guys are spending, you know, not my money but millions of dollars to get this property to have people write it, and no one ever sits and reads it. As an artist, that is so counterintuitive to me. That, and even my Fox thing, we've never read it. They're gonna make a decision on it. They just read it and give me notes. So that drives me crazy. So I think at a certain point in my life, I kind of went, I'm so tired of doing this. I wanna commune with the people that I can commune with, which is, so you, these people, writing stuff, performing for people, because that's why I'm here.
So I think for a lot of people, they just assume that funny is funny, that you wake up and you're funny and you go to sleep and you're funny and that it isn't a craft. And yet the more I've read and the more I've watched and the more I've been around comedians, it is a really, really grueling kind of workmanlike just getting in there and writing. And I saw this thing where Sarah Silverman said some comedians are just, you know, really lazy bastards. And
right.
Then there's the Jerry Seinfelds who are like the ultimate craftsmen and they
right.
work a joke and work a joke and work a joke. Where do you come in all that?
Oh, I'm a total obsessive freak.
Yeah?
I mean, I actually love language and I love the idea that I love joke craftsmanship and I love comedy craftsmanship. And I love, even though my shows are always raw and I never rehearse them, like I working with the great Blake Brooker, they do One Yellow Rabbit shows. They rehearse for 6 weeks. I rehearse for 3 days. And it drives him crazy because I don't really know it, but I kind of do. But I do love that like you'll get a laugh if you move on this line and if you don't, or if you just lean or something. I love just the specifics of the mechanics of how laughs and things work. I really do. So I'm all about crafting stuff, and I'm the a-hole in the kids in the hall who, you know, at the end of the tour, on the last show of a 60-show tour, I still am going, I think the lights are a little bit late on that thing. And they're all enjoying themselves, and I'm going, why can't the light be on a 3 count? I mean, And so I drive myself crazy, but I also enjoy it.
Yeah, but the work is good then. I was thinking about the kids in the hall, and I was thinking that there was this thing where you guys once said, well, there were like 5 lead guitarists. And I was thinking about this idea of like 5-person groups. And the only equivalent I could come up with were like boy bands.
Right.
So like One Direction and NSYNC. So are you like the Justin Timberlake of the kids in the hall?
No, I'm one of the other guys whose name you don't know or can't remember.
Seriously? You're not Joey Fatone?
Yeah. I can't, I don't even know
you
another
know who
name.
He is?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think I've met him actually. Sorry, Joey, I know you're watching this. No, I think, you know, I actually think we're 5 bass players, the kids in the hall. And I think, yeah, well, that's not a very good band.
No.
Except for the weirdest goth girls in the world with like a 5 bass player, thump it out daddy kind of band. But no, I think that we're 5 really smart guys, but together as a troupe, we're 1 really dumb guy. Which I've often thought, like 1 really dumb guy. Like we have no instincts on what to do or how to do it or to stop or start or shut up or take a deal or not take a deal. We're stupid. But no, we are a band, and that's why I love like reading books about the Rolling Stones, not that we're the Rolling Stones, or anybody, and or you know seeing a documentary on Drive-By Truckers, a band I love who aren't very famous. But it's like just because the politics are so interesting. And of course, for me, I've had 2 families or 3 families in my life. The terrible one I crawled out of, the wonderful one that I didn't realize was great with the kids in the hall, and then now the one I have with my beautiful wife and 2 kids. And so it's so interesting for me, and I am fascinated about how young men come together. And this guy writes the song, and this guy shouldn't stand there, and you shouldn't move around so much, and that you have to figure it out as you're forming who you are.
Yeah.
And that was so hard and interesting for me with the troupe.
So I don't know if all of you know this, but you will very soon. Bruce is writing a book. He's writing his first book, and he's kind of going through, and it's not an autobiography, right? It's how would you describe
it? It's sort of a surreal autobiography or something. I'm writing stories about the weird things that happened in my life. I make them a bit different. You know, like my son, I say he's, you know, he wants to be a sommelier when he's six, and that's not really true.
But so wouldn't it be lovely if it were?
I would love a young sommelier around the house. but it's sort of stories about my weird life, my family, and my journey into being a young asshole, into being hopefully a better man now that I'm a bit older. So it's just weird stories about my life.
So as you're doing it, I was thinking a lot about this, and like, is it easier to be the asshole than to be kind of a fully realized mature human being?
Oh, well, no one wants to hear that you're a mature human being.
Yeah.
I mean, and no one, it's like, I had a friend whose name I won't mention, he did two solo records, and one was about his gruesome divorce, and it was fantastic. And then he did one about how he'd found love, and it was so, you know, the sunlight on her face, and was like water going to the desert. And it's like, not so good. And I think people want people to have problems, because you're working on problems. To go like, oh, my wife's so wonderful. No one wants to hear that. No one wants to hear that.
So you've got a wealth of material.
Yeah.
Although you have a wonderful wife, but you also have some stuff.
Yeah,
that wasn't.
And but you know, what's life? Life's hard.
Life is very hard. Life is very hard. So give me a sense of what your day's like, because you have assistants, and you get in your little room.
Well, I have one assistant.
Okay, an assistant.
Yeah. Well, no, I get up. Sometimes I get up at 5. If I have to write, I get up at 5. When I was doing Carpoolers, I remember calling Greg Garcia, who had done My Name is Earl. It was organized somehow that I could call Greg Garcia and get his advice. And he said, hi, how are you doing? And I said, well, what do you do? What do you do? How do you do this? And he said, well, you get up at 4:30 in the morning. And I laughed my head off. And then I found sometimes you have to get up at 4:30 in the morning. So if I'm actually writing, I sometimes get up at 4:30, or I like to get up at 5. Is good for me. And then I write a bit, take my kids to school, and then go for a walk, my assistant comes over, we start talking about what we're working on. She kind of figures some stuff out and writes up some notes, and then I go to the gym, I come back, we do a little work, I have lunch, a nap, a little bit more work, and that's it.
Okay.
Does that sound good or terrible?
What do you think, guys?
Yeah.
So I was able to visit your starter mansion, mm-hmm. in the Hollywood Hills. It's really cool, you guys, and it's everything you think it's going to be. But there's this art collection that you have in your house. And one of the things I heard you say once on the radio that you had built a life on the quality of your ideas. And I thought, man, that is so cool. Like, how many of us can say that we built a life on our ideas? And some of the life that you've built, you've amassed a pretty killer art collection. Do you want to talk about that? Because we're at the Banff Center, and it's about all kinds of art.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting because the troupe, it's like so funny. It's like I have this, like I'm such an asshole, you know, with my art collection. And it actually started very young. I remember going into, there was a show, Four Modern Masters, when I was in Calgary, which was Klee, Magritte, and a couple other people. And it was like, DeChirco, and I was like, oh my God. And I felt like this thing, this almost like visceral, like I was sexually aroused by how cool this art was. And I always put that away that someday I would get art. And then when I started to get a little tiny bit of money, I started getting art. And I remember once at the second year of the Kids in the Hall show, like we didn't get paid very well. I don't have that much money. I worry about money all the time, by the way. And Lorne Michaels said, you know, you guys have done really well. You don't complain. My voice tired. I can do better, Lauren, some other night. And he said, you know, I'm gonna buy you guys cars. And we all went cars, and we thought he was joking. He's like, no, I'm gonna buy you cars. And oh, cool. Oh, thanks. Yeah. And so he gave us money for cars. And I remember seeing a big Tom Hopkins painting. It was like 6 feet by 8 feet that I'd seen. And I thought, I'm gonna get that painting. And it was like, can I get a painting instead? So I got this painting, and it wasn't, you know, it was $8,000, $9,000. And that sort of started my thing. And of course, no one in the troupe got cars. They all took the money. except Kevin McDonald got a car, because he was told, he thought he was supposed to. And Kevin McDonald didn't drive. And then he lost it later in a divorce. So I guess that's why he got the car. But I've been collecting art my wife and I for probably 15 years, and we have, you know, we look like crazy cat people with all our art. You know, all, you know, we have some really cool, a little group of seven stuff, but more weird Montreal stuff and Max Bates and Glide and all those people that have associations or some of them with the center. And it's just so wonderful to me to look at, you know, a Max Bates painting that he did one day in 1941. And he is a weirdo and I'm a weirdo. And he did that day and we get to have it. Or not, we don't have it, it's still his. And it'll be our children's someday, or we'll, perhaps we'll sell it if I get broke. And I don't know, it's just so great to be around other people's ideas somehow.
I love that. So the other discipline at the Banff Center that you are a practitioner of, obviously, is dance. And I want to talk about I want to talk about the physicality of your act.
Like, right.
Because we can just sit and talk, but it isn't the same. You're talking about delivery and
right.
when you move. Talk
right.
about the physicality of the act.
Well, you know, it's funny because I think, I actually, and I'm not saying this so you'll go, oh no, Bruce, you're so great. I can't watch myself. I think, I perform, I look like a flopping, dying fish to me. You know, my head's always moving, I'm bobbing around. You know, I watch the kids in the hall show, I go, he's a genius. Who's that guy with the jumbo goddamn head? And I'm always moving, but I don't know. I feel in my body, I suppose, I'm a weirdo. And I've had no traditional training at all. I can't actually dance. I can't actually sing. You know, my wife once pointed out, I can't actually do anything. You know, I'll direct a film. I can kind of go, oh, they should stand over there, but I can't build the thing they're standing in. I can't operate a camera. So I can't actually dance. I can't actually sing. I just do all those things. So it's spontaneous, and I've, you know, the odd time a dancer has tried to work with us, like, you know, do something, or, you know, and I make them cry. They lose their spirit really quickly because I can't do it. I'm terrible, but I can move, I think.
So during the act, are there certain jokes that are like go-to jokes for you, or certain sections in or certain bits where you're just like, yeah, if I get to there, I can just reconnect with the whole thing?
Well, yes, you have really safe places, you know, and there's other things that can be just a bit off or something. I mean, that is the wonderful thing about doing a show like I'm doing, which is like it really is alive and weird, and it comes at you in different ways, and it isn't the audience, it's you. And so there are things that you can get to that where you can kind of rest a little bit. And of course, once you start to know a show and it starts to work with people, then it takes care of you, which is really wonderful. Because mostly I'm doing stuff I don't even know what it is yet. And I haven't done it that many times. You know, the kids in the hall and I just, we did some new material shows in Toronto. And it was my concept that they luckily took. We'd rehearse for 5 days and write material. We would do 5 shows in a 500-seat theater. And so that we did that. And so we were on stage with all this new material that we were trying to light and get costumes for so fast. And it's like, we don't even know this stuff. And so, and it was fun, of course, and it actually was pretty good. But it's like, we don't even know it yet. And there is something that great people like One Yellow Rabbit and a lot, you know, people like that, they know what it's like to actually know a show. And I'm sort of, I have my toe almost in that pool right now that I kind of know my show, and it can be wonderful.
Is there a particular point in Young Drunk Punk, now that you've done it 4 nights in a row,
right.
Where something solidified for you last night? You just went, oh yeah, I know that, I'm in that.
Yeah, yeah.
Can you tell us what that section was, what that bit was?
Well, I do a long monologue based on some of the things that happened with my wife, and of course I made up a lot of other things about my wife. It's just a story that felt like I was connecting with the audience and the material, and it's pretty good, and I know that works, that joke's nice, that's good, and then this thing, and then they think it's going to stop. No, it keeps going, and it kept going, and then it's going to get sad, and it got sad. So it was, for me, that was just like really fun to be able to do that.
Now you also, Angie the HIV Unicorn, which is a piece that is sort of beginning, middle, and end of the show, is a stubborn piece for you. It's an idea you had that you didn't want to give up.
Yeah.
Are there other ideas, like other bits or other jokes that you just are determined, like a dog, to take and make us love it?
Oh, not make it love it, me understand it.
You know,
sometimes I write something, it will take 5 minutes. You know, Angie the HIV Unicorn, which is, you know, about a children's book.
Yes, of course.
Theoretically that I was writing, my agent didn't like. It was like, I want to do Angie the HIV Unicorn. And my assistant would say, we'd put it on our task sheet. We used to have a you know, I'd say, we should do a task sheet, which I did it sort of like, oh, it's so cruel to have a task sheet. So we did it ironically, and now we actually have a task sheet. And there's no irony. Where's the task sheet? You haven't updated the task sheet. And I would say, what are other tasks? And she would say, well, we have to write Angie the HIV Unicorn. I'd say, okay, what else? And for like a year and a half, 2 years, I couldn't write Angie the HIV Unicorn. I knew I wanted to write it, but I had no ideas for it. So finally, I wrote that little song, but sometimes it takes forever, and sometimes it doesn't. So I have things that I haven't figured out yet, and I have things that come from nowhere, boom, into my head, and they go out first.
There was a thing that, because comedians are really smart, right? And you read about comedians, and they have a really great way of talking about their craft. And Steve Martin did a really great piece, and he was talking about how it was really important that it be funny now, but it would be even more important that it be funny later, that the audience was going to go home and think about the bits. And he talked about the perfect bit as being something that I really think describes you and your humor and your take. And it's bits that had enough strangeness to linger.
Right.
Does that resonate for you? That it's strange enough to linger?
Oh, God, yeah. No, it's like a weird thought if you see a show or a thing that, you know, One Yellow Rabbit just did this piece where this guy comes out in a weird bird's head, and they're supposed to guess who he is, and they interview him for like 8 minutes because it's a One Yellow Rabbit show. In my show, it might be 4 minutes, but it's like that image is just so strange, and I don't, you know, I'm not thinking about all the things he said, but just that weird image and the quality of his voice, and so yeah, no, that's for me what remains for shows often is weird little things.
So the show that Bruce is talking about is called Munich Now, and it's playing at the High Performance Rodeo for the next week in Calgary. So you can all see the weirdness and see if it lingers for you too. I think what you're getting a sense of too is Bruce's incredible generosity to his friends. And you have new friends, but you also have a lot of old friends. And how does that at this point in your life kind of work for you, that idea of
Well, it's that terrible cliche is you can't meet old friends.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think I was a guy who didn't, you know, I grew up angry and I grew up stupid and I got in lots of fights and I crashed my car and I can't believe I never got a DUI. And, you know, I think that people from that era who knew me and actually loved me despite myself and hopefully love me now if I'm a slight better person, it's so wonderful to have Brian Connelly, my oldest friend in the world, who I've known since I was 13, you know, that's 40 years, on stage with me. And it's so great to just know each other. So, but I also think I went through an era when the Kids in the Hall was forming and when I was doing my directing, a couple studio movies or whatever, that I didn't know how important my friends were because I was busting into the world still, especially in the Kids in the Hall because I was take no prisoners. So I think in the beginning of my life, I needed my friends for identity. I kind of let them go a little bit as I drove myself towards success and got kind of lucky. And then I think I found them now in kind of a quieter time in my life.
And so I think we're all, I mean, a little starstruck, you know, and you're kind of, yes, we're starstruck, Bruce. And you're living in the age of, you know, this is the golden age of comedy, right? Where Tina Fey is the smartest woman in the world.
Right.
Like, that's the kind of world we live in. And I assume you know Tina Fey.
I do know Tina Fey.
And we were talking about Will Ferrell last night, and you said he was like a really nice guy, and that makes me so happy to know that what you see is what you get there.
Yeah.
So is this the age of the kind of well-adjusted comedian?
No, I think people all have weird souls or weird beginnings. If you read Tina Fey's book, you know, she had trouble in the beginning. Molly Shannon, who's the nicest person in the world, you know, we connect through, you know, she had a very tough childhood and her spirit, her story is kind of like mine. She has a family and she's so happy that she never thought she'd have a family. And so I think there's a lot of good people. There's a lot of damaged people who aren't nice in show business. But you kind of want to stay away from those and you befriend the ones that are, you know, Amy Poehler is, and I don't know her well, I've met her, apparently the nicest woman in the world. And I've heard stories about her helping people in ways that are so profound. And it's like, oh, that's so good. And you kind of comes off her. You just go, oh, I like her.
I like her. So the really rich part of the show last night for me was a story that I feel a really strong connection to, which is a story about your father.
Right.
And in many ways, that's the thread that goes in, which is you wanting to beat up your father. And I never understand why people laugh at that. I find that, why do people laugh at beating up your father?
Well, everyone wants to beat up their father.
Really?
Yeah, or maybe throw some red wine on their mother.
Okay, I'm there. I can do that. Yeah, okay.
Well, I think it's the primitive thing is you have to, if you're going to be an alpha, you got to take on the alpha in the house. You know, the bastard who controls the TV remote. And you're going to take him on one day. And I think all the guys kind of understand that. I think most of us never did punch our dads, but we really did think about it. And of course, in my show, there's the eventual journey, which sadly most of us go through, which is parents become our children and we end up feeding them applesauce in the end. And you know, that's just the way it works.
And when you talk about those things that linger, for me, one of them is that thing where you stop as you're feeding your dad the applesauce and you look inside your dad's mouth. Like, to have the, I don't know, A, to see it, B, to get it, and then three, to feel confident enough to share it with all of us, because
right.
That's a pretty specifically weird image.
Well, it's weird, and it's what I'm not as comfortable with in a way, because I really want to be funny. And I know kind of that's my job, but I do like that ever so often, I am a real humanist, and I really do love people. So ever so often, you can't talk about that too much, or you really are a jerk. So, but ever so often, to touch down in something about, you know, and as corny as it is, like, my beautiful wife asleep. Like, I can barely even say that now, because it's so corny. But to be able to connect with people, you know, looking in your dying dad's mouth, that it could be your last time. And I can only do it if I think it's not just about me, that it's for other people. Because it's, you know, about my other friends who, my great Karen Hines, who played the crazy chick in my show. She had the greatest line about, you know, a lot of us having trouble with parents and getting sick and elderly and some of them dying. It's raining parents. And it, you know, so I only do that piece because it connects with other people who have sick people. So I can only do that if I think it's not for me, because I don't need a catharsis about my dad. I want to have catharsis about that, hey, we got to bury our folks, right, and then move on.
Because it's like being a kid who grows up, right? I mean, you really, literally are having to be a kid who grew up
right.
In front of all of us and in himself, and then to, at this point, try to figure out what your work is.
Right.
You know, what's your take? And is that kind of where you're at right now? Just trying to figure all those things out?
Yeah, well, I don't even think about what my work is. I just sort of instinctively just do stuff. And I never have a path, or I never know what I'm going to do next, and I never know what's going to gather interest for me. And you know, I just instinctively do stuff, and it's always hard. I always don't know what I'm doing. I always don't know what my next show is, my show idea, and then something always comes.
Cool. Well, I think this is a really good time maybe to turn to the audience and have you guys ask some questions to Bruce. There are two mics at the foot of the stairs. And if you'd like to come down and...
Like they used to do on the Donahue show.
It's exactly like the Donahue show. Or the Mike Douglas show.
Oh,
I wish we were on the Mike Douglas show.
I wish
show.
So, too. Look, the light went up, and no one came down. That was the saddest thing I've ever seen. Didn't we hire someone
I thought we did.
And
I thought we did. Here we go.
Ask questions?
You still owe me the money,
Oh, that's
though.
My personal assistant. Pretend to not know me, and ask me a question.
I was just thinking about something as you finished up with the you never know what's going to happen next. And I wonder how much navigation you do between like your non-sequitur comedy, your very random turns of phrase.
Right.
Versus randomness actually being inspired by something that actually happened in your life. You know, do you find that those actually do clash together more often than not, or is non sequitur purely non sequitur all the time?
Well, it's a little bit of both. Like I just, you know, I will find a phrase that interests me. You know, the most sort of random thing I probably ever did was something called 30 Helens Agree, which was a thing for the kids in the hall, and I just thought it would be good to have 30 Helens, women named Helen, standing in a field giving us advice. And I just got that idea. It wasn't based on a Helen I knew. You know, so those for me, in terms of creativity, are the true gifts that just pop into your head. They just, like, and those ones feel like a warm egg breaking inside your brain. So I think those are some weird connection with the spirit or your spirit. And they come, and you go, where did that come from? I mean, last night I was just doing a thing, like looking at my reflection in my coffee cup, and it was so off the rails, and it was so fun for me, and it was so going nowhere, and I was killing my own show, and I was shooting it in the head, but I was loving it, and I didn't know where it came from. And then other times, of course, you can construct how surreal you can be. You know, we had a long conversation with my director. We do a surreal piece where we play Wichita Lineman by Glen Campbell. It can only be that song. And, you know, then a blender comes out and we blend up some cheeseburgers and French fries and eat them, and which we thought was fantastic. And then we did a weird thing afterwards. So the conversation about can we do one or two, you know, I'll have forever, but where they came from, we don't really know.
So Wichita Lineman, because even if I didn't know you, even if I didn't feel like I knew you, like, he's like, the kids in the hall are like the Kevin Bacons of Canada. Everybody in Canada feels like they know a kid in
right.
some way. I would love you for Wichita Lineman. And that's the last thing in the world you expect to see it in a comedy or a sketch thing, but I would love you for Wichita Lineman. So why is that the only song?
I don't know. And
it just is.
Every kid in the hall would have the same stubbornness about something. Like, no, it can't be a turkey. It has to be a chicken. And that's where we have our fights. That's where we always traditionally had our fights. We'd never go, well, comedy is in threes, you know. It would be like the weird, stubborn stuff. Like, no, the time machine has to be the same size as people. It can't be, the time machine can't be bigger than people. Well, a time machine doesn't actually exist, Dave. But we get stubborn about the things we think we've created, but not like, maybe that ending doesn't work. We don't get stubborn about that. So I don't know.
Wichita Lineman, yes, please.
Actually, on a related note, I was reading a biography of Monty Python recently, and as I am with kids in the hall, I'm a big fan of Monty Python. And John Cleese was talking about why he sort of stepped away from the series. And he said, you know, if I'm going to fail, I want to fail on my own,
right.
my own work, instead of failing as a group of six.
Right.
So can you talk a little bit more about the tension between operating as your own artist with your own material versus then going back and working with four other very opinionated artists and writers and performers?
Right. Well, a great question. I like when people always say that. Great question.
It's a great question.
I thought of before as I walked out I was going to do that after every question, but then I decided not to. Well, first of all, as a young person, when I was a young man, we all were, we didn't want to define ourselves as the kids in the hall. And I was the writer. I would go to Tarragon Theater on the off season, and I would make sure we had longer seasons so I could do my one-man show. And I think as I got older, I got over myself. And I realized, especially in some of the bumps I've had in my career, and as Scott Thompson says, you know, none of us really lit up the world, did we? And which is true. And that the work I do with the kids in the hall is actually more like me in some way than some of the work I do on my own, which I haven't figured out. And I was having lunch with Dave Thomas, who I totally admire, and he wanted to have lunch with me, and we're sort of old friends. And, you know, we were laughing, and I was saying, well, you know, they're going to be wearing toques at your funeral. And he said, yeah, and they're going to be, you know, wearing cabbages on their heads at yours. And I love that. I love that I've come through this thing, and I'm now in my 50s. I'm not a kid. I'm an old man. And that our work that started as a young people, to me, is still my life's work. And I'm not, you know, people don't have to mention my book. I don't care. Like, I love my book. I'll love it more than anything. But I will die a kid in the hall. And I think we're all now comfortable with that notion. And so when we come together, we really like each other in a way that we never had. You know, I think on the last tour we did, you know, we were used to, when we were younger and more successful, we were used to shows selling out right away and them saying, can we add more shows? And we were going, no, we don't want to. And, you know, the last tour, there was a lot of empty seats. And we were struggling. Can't we get more interviews in Green Bay? We got to move some seats. And then here we were, four men, and Scott was almost turning 50 then, like sort of, you know, and there were some marriage issues with some of the guys. And it was like, we were healing ourselves on this weird tour bus, with, you know, going to cities. Some were sold out and some really weren't. And I think we came together and realized that we wanted to work this thing that we'd started as young men.
Do you have another one? Yep.
I'm kind of interested in the arc of your career. Like it almost seems like it's the way that people are working more these days than in the past, that you kind of see opportunities and you grab them and you sort of choose to do this but not choose to do that. There's never like a career job as a comedian. You make
right.
your own way. I'm wondering if you could sort of what sort of advice would you give to people who are now in sort of a job market where you are just sort of constantly searching for your next kind of gig?
Right.
And do you look back on certain things that you did and think sort of, I wish I went with that other thing as opposed to waiting or something like that?
Great question. No, you know, I've given you different advice probably 8 years ago than I will give you now. You know, what I used to say was pick a job. You know, that's why I stubbornly became a film director. Like, I'd start directing short films in the kids in the hall, and I wasn't going to come back for the third season unless I got 10 films. And then I ended up getting 8. Okay, I'll come back. And so pick a job, I used to say. But now I don't say that anymore. Now I say find a little creative thing that is interesting, and you never know how far that's going to lead. Case in point, you know, it's Shelley here who's the reason I'm writing a book, and in fact doing a one-man show, because she asked me to do a piece for Swerve magazine, and I was happy to do it, and then I wanted to do another one, and then I wanted to do another one, and then eventually someone asked me to come do a one-man show, and I thought, I'm going to sell a book at this one-man show, and it worked out, and I thought, oh, to do that, I have to go on Gameshi, and give the show a name. What's my name? Young Drunk Punk. Was that a weird name? Okay, what's that show? And so it wasn't like, oh, I'm going to... It was just a small impulse that I kind of followed, and then that's like almost the only time it's ever worked out for me, by the way, so maybe it's not good advice. You never know how your little thing is going to keep moving. So I think, you know, I don't know as a technician or whatever, but as an artist, I think it's all these little things you do that actually add up. And then at some point, you look around and go, all these weird things I did actually make a bigger one thing. So it doesn't mean like, so you don't have to, you know, audition for Tarragon and get in their season or whatever. It can be a weird play, another thing, and before you know it, you'll have created your own gravity.
Wow. I love that answer. Just so you guys know, the secret to editing Bruce McCulloch is he answers the phone and says yes. That's the secret to editing Bruce McCulloch. And so a lot of this is also putting in the work and having the goods. So it's kind of a meritocracy, right?
In what way?
In that if you're good, you'll get work.
Yes and no. I also think it's random. You know, I met the other kids in the hall, and I met Brian Connelly and became friends with Blake Brooker. I may not have met those guys. If I hadn't met my friends, I may be a drunk guy working in a warehouse, the funniest guy who's works in the warehouse and has a weird, bad marriage. You know, I think it is luck, but I think I do, your protection against bad luck is working hard. And also, the thing I only can touch now and then is actually enjoying your work and being fun to work with. I never knew that when I was in my 20s, that you were supposed to be fun to work with. I just thought, get out of my way, I'm gonna be really good in this one. And now, if you're not enjoying your work, then you're not enjoying your life.
Okay, so great answer. And if this hadn't happened, you'd be Ricky.
That's right.
You'd have Ricky on your name instead
That's
of
right.
Bruce. I love that. Great answer.
Well, thank you.
You're welcome. And thank all of you for fantastic questions. And at this point, I think we're going to have to wrap it up.
Great.
Because Bruce has been talking nonstop for 5 straight days, right?
Yes, I'm going to have my hips replaced. because I've been, you know, on stage and they're sore. So I get them replaced every week or so, and today is the day. Well, thank you so much for coming.
Thank you all very, very, very much.